This woman says that she was abducted by beings from another planet and taken on board their spaceship, where she experienced a bizarre, unforgettable journey in time and space. Now, what makes her story credible is the work that a team of UFO researchers headed by this man did to document the incident. Now, the results of their findings are reported in this fascinating book, The Andreasson Affair. Would you please welcome Betty Andreasson and Raymond E. Fowler. Yeah. On television. May I tell you, Betty?
Yes, sir.
Where you're up against the time element, then it would be difficult for you to condense this whole experience. But could you briefly tell us what happened?
Well, it was evening, and suddenly the lights went out in my home, and a red orange pulsating light came from the pantry window. Suddenly, there were five beings in my home. One went over to the side where I did not see them. Then the other four and I went into the living room where my family was placed in a state of suspended animation. And for a short period of time, my daughter Becky was taken out to show me that my family was all right. From there, I was taken out into the kitchen again. And meanwhile, my father was off to the side in the pantry area with one of the beings. And he, too, was placed in a state of suspended animation. I was taken out into the backyard, and I was taken aboard their craft. And I was given extensive examination, brought to a strange place, and then returned home.
What do you mean by brought to a strange place? Aboard the craft?
Yes, I was taken aboard the craft, and they took me through different rooms and put me through different things. And finally, they took me into this strange place where there was a red atmosphere and a green atmosphere.
Did you maintain consciousness through all this experience?
Yes, I did. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Did they, how did they communicate with you?
Through mental telepathy. Their voice was English and had a slight foreign accent to it.
They left a small blue book with you.
Yes.
Describe that.
It was a very thin book. It had approximately 40 pages to it. The first three pages were very, very bright, almost appeared like light. There were different images within it, different formulas, pictures of the craft, strange writing. There were numbers.
Did you see this blue book, Mr. Collins?
No, she only had it for 10 days. They told us she could keep it for 10 days to study, and then it would disappear. And, of course, we didn't hear about the case until 1977, and it's due late.
Did it disappear, as they said, in 10
yes,
days?
Yes, oh. 10 days.
Just suddenly wasn't there, right?
Wasn't there any longer.
Now, a bust was made from your description of the figures.
This was given to me as a gift from a person that had been
Yeah, Zeus, they're not very attractive looking, are they?
Depends on the point of view, of course. Then.
Yeah. How tall are they?
They were about 4 feet tall. And as you see, they had cat-like eyes, very large eyes. They had only three fingers on each hand.
Anything to resemble a thumb, or were they all like
that? Yes, one was a little thicker than the other two, so it must have been sort of like
now, we have some diagrams which show what the spaceship looked like. Well, can we look at those?
Yes.
Hey, let's hold them to this camera.
Okay.
This is a side view here that we're looking at?
Yes. These on the bottom. When I was taken outside, the leader, whose name was Klausdorf, made the bottom transparent so I was able to see these things. These were glass balls. They were like cut crystal. And these arms were aluminum type and had like rings around them. These two arms stretched out, and this was a glass-like wheel, cut wheel. And it revolved around an inner tube type thing. On the very top was another glass wheel that was very, very bright, and it sent off bars of light from it.
Now, are these floor levels that we're looking at here?
Yes.
What areas did you travel to?
Well, I was
taking you all through the craft?
Yes. I believe there's some on this picture.
Now, can you see this on camera while you're pointing out the... let me get it for a little bit here.
Okay, go ahead.
Let's see.
In here. And then I was brought up the circular stairs into an upper room, and I was in there noticing many different things, and then they took me down through an elevator, through an elevator and into this room, where I was...
The elevator went down, is that the idea?
where I was put under a light, a cleansing device. Then I was taken into this.
How did you know it was a cleansing device?
Well, they had told me that I was being cleansed, and a bright light came down and engulfed me. From there, I was taken into this cubicle, and I was to change into a garment that was provided for me. From there, I was brought into the examining room, and on this table, where I underwent the examinations that they put me through.
Was it like a medical examination in any way?
Similar. The first one was measurement for life. The second one, they inserted a needle in my left nostril and broke through the membrane, which was very, very painful. And the leader came forth and put his hand on my head and relieved some of the pain. When he reached
through, and he put his hand on your head, it relieved the pain?
Released some of the pain, yes. There was still pain present. When he pulled the needle out of my nose, there was a tiny beady-like object on the end with tiny wire-like whiskers. And then they commenced to do a second needle probing, which they put in my navel. And I felt the vibration, and again, that was very painful. And the leader again put his hand on my forehead and relieved me of some of the pain.
Put his hand on your forehead and relieved the pain in your
stomach? Yes. Yes. Mm. And they stepped off to the side and started discussing that they wanted to do more tests. And I knew they were saying this, and the leader was objecting to this. When the others were insisting, and I screamed I didn't want any more tests and to get that thing out of me, and he came over and he took it out, and he told me just a few moments more, and then a large eye-like device came out of the dome ceiling and came by my stomach and scanned my whole body, and from there that was the end of the test.
Good. Now you painted 8 pictures which describe what everything looked like. Can we see those pictures?
That is the beings coming right through the door, and they came so that there was like a mist in back of them, as if there was another slot.
Is that what their uniforms look like?
Yes.
Like uniforms.
It was a wool color look to it, with a sparkly, almost like sandpaper sparkles when light hits it, and that's them coming through the door. Here they are in the living room, and we are exchanging the books. And the three beings are standing beside him, and there's always a slot in back of the leader, and I couldn't understand what happened.
He was taller than the other three,
yes,
was he?
Yes, he was. He was taller. I couldn't understand why I kept seeing that slot in the back, but that was the place where I was going to have to sit. And so they took me out into the yard, and here he is making the bottom of the craft transparent and showing me the different things. And I asked him questions, but he only told me as much as he wanted to tell me.
Hmm.
Here they were changed into an aluminum-type that glistened and shined when
Where did they change when they got aboard the craft?
Yes. In the examining room is when I first saw them in these uniforms. Here is where I am being examined, and the different utensils and things that were used during the
examination. Is that the scanning machine above you there?
Yes. It was like an eye.
An x-ray machine,
maybe. Yes. Off to the left is a fan-like apparatus. This is when I was brought into the room housing 8 glass-like chairs. And
what is that in front of you? Is that a desk or what?
No, that is a chair that encompassed me. A hood came down close around me, and gray liquid filled the chair. They had
gray liquid?
Yes, which swirled around my body. And they gave me some red medicine, some red stuff to drink, and it soothed me. This is a picture of the beings that were in the red atmosphere. Very strange. They had like 2 stalks and moved independently. The eyes just could look anywhere. This is a picture of my father in back of the wall in the pantry in a state of suspended animation, the being holding a white light that made him shuffle out of the area, yet he was not conscious of what was going on.
Did any of your family remember any of this?
My father remembered seeing them when they came out of their craft into the house. He remembered seeing them coughing. And he thought it was children dressed up in Halloween costumes.
Is that the way they get from here to there? They hop.
When they're outside the craft. Inside the craft, they glide very easily.
They don't walk quickly.
No.
1 foot in front of the other.
No.
I see.
And my daughter also. When she was taken out of the suspended animation for a few moments for me to see that my family was all right.
We'll have more on this strange journey following these messages. Well, we've heard Betty's story, Raymond. Were you skeptical when you first heard about?
I must admit that I was. In fact, I tried to persuade our local investigators to have nothing to do with this woman. But they persisted, and as director of investigations for the Mutual UFO Network and residing in Massachusetts, I often looked over the investigations being carried on by the Massachusetts team. And after an initial character reference check was made, indicating that she seemed to be a very reliable person, I became a member of a five-man team consisting of an aerospace engineer, a solar physicist, and other people with technical backgrounds, and performed the character reference check myself.
What are your credentials as an investigatorship?
Well, I served as an early warning coordinator with the United States Air Force-sponsored University of Colorado project. I've been advised at the NICAP. I presently am with Dr. Hynek's Center for UFO Studies, and I'm director of investigations on the board of directors for an international group called the Mutual UFO Network. I conducted the character reference check. We checked with her neighbors and lawyers, ministers, etc. We gave her two extensive lie detector tests, not only her, but her daughters, to establish whether or not they were trying to perpetrate a very clever hoax. And they passed the test with flying colors. The next question that came to mind was, was she a psychotic? And we had her sit down with a psychiatrist who assured her that she was not a psychotic, that she really believed the account, and he couldn't account for the stimulus that was outside of his expertise. Now, of course, we used 14 hypnotic regression sessions to bring out the amnesic portion. In very vivid detail, she relived this. She just didn't talk about it like she is today. She was there.
Were there any variations?
No. This was the interesting thing to me. The hypnotist could bring her back to relive a segment over again, and it was just like winding back a tape recorder.
Mm.
Watching Becky, for example, relive it as an 11-year-old was fascinating, because you had a girl in her 20s sitting there in the hypnotist's chair, using the vocabulary of an 11-year-old girl, describing the clay creatures talking to Mummy with the same fear and everything that she had experienced then. It was a fascinating thing to be part of.
Why do you suppose, Betty, that you were singled out? Have we established for everyone listening where you're from and what is all took place?
I think took place in Massachusetts. And I don't believe that I'm just the only one that's been singled out, because they told me that they've had many people aboard their craft, and that they have lost information in their minds, and it will come out in time.
Lost information into the minds of the people that have been
contacted? Yes, that has been contacted.
Hmm. Are they friendly people?
They say that they love me unkind, and they want to help the world, what they told me.
Are they satisfied with that? I'm sorry. Are you satisfied that that's the case?
Well, I feel as if it's the case. They've been giving me different things, writings and things about what is taking place and happening, and these are all being checked through.
Other technology is certainly superior up to ours, isn't it?
I really don't understand
the
technology.
Well, here they are, extraterrestrial, and this isn't something more complex than this. Of course, interstellar space travel is beyond our technology. The distances are so vast, the speed of light seems to be a
constant. Well, for anyone,
it seems incredible.
I've talked to astronauts, I've talked to pilots, and they always say almost the same thing, that they'd be chasing them, and suddenly they just point upward and speeds absolutely beyond belief, climbing speeds, where they practically burn up jet craft to stay near them,
Excuse me, Mike, go ahead. I have a couple questions. First of all, in the book, I get the impression that from your point of view, this has a religious connotation somehow, and that from your point of view, that's yet to be decided.
That's correct.
You have maintained that you think they, whoever they are on our side. They're on, they have positive feelings about mankind. But you mentioned them breaking in on telephone calls, being very angry.
Well, they told me.
You're being monitored, then, right?
Yes, they told me that that there are seven races visiting the Earth, and one is detrimental to man.
You brought up something that I definitely want to get on the air. It's an audio tape of Betty under hypnosis as she describes the physical examination that these beings gave her. Let's listen to this tape of her under hypnosis.
Getting ready for something to sound by my feet somewhere. And doing something, and I'm pushing the figure on something. There must be something down there that's wrong, and I see it. That is pulling something, that needle again, or the tube, like on the end of pulling. I keep calling it. Around in my stomach, on my body. they stopped. You've got to take the thing out. Thank you. I don't want any more tests.
Thank you, Raymond Fowler.